It is certainly an honor to be back here again this year, and thank you to Medline for asking me to return. The changing and expectations for quality. I tell you, I really put a lot of thought trying to figure out, okay, how do we talk about this? What are the changing expectations? And I tell you, I went back to an Institute of Medicine study that was actually released, I think, in 2001. And while I don't want to say to any of you that I think that there was actually a master plan or a complete blueprint for healthcare reform, for what was in healthcare reform that had a blueprint, it's from the Institute of Medicine study, Crossing the Quality Chasm. This particular study has even greater impact for us now, because one of the individuals that served on the committee that did this study is Dr. Don Berwick, who is now the administrator of CMS. And in one of his very first meetings that he had with his staff, he talked about crossing the quality chasm from two different perspectives. One, he wanted to use the principles set forth in this study to be able to put together an operational plan for CMS and how he would administer the programs there. The second thing he wanted to do is make sure that the quality expectations that were set forth again in this, I think, masterful study would be used as he took on the challenge of implementing healthcare reform. You know, the subtitle under Crossing the Quality Chasm gives us the very first hint that this is somewhat different, because it does not say a new healthcare system for the 21st century. It says a new health system, meaning for the first time ever, I think in America's history, that we need a system that actually gives equal attention to health, staying healthy, that those of us that are healthcare professionals should be able to educate and communicate, and that we should also take a responsibility for our own personal health. The six aims that are set forth in this particular study, and I gave my first presentation on crossing the quality chasm in, I think, 2002. If you haven't read this study, you can get it from Amazon. We all need to read it. The six aims of this system: number one, safe. Safe. Now, again, as healthcare professionals, we all know do no harm. We have heard that for the entire time that we've been in medical school or nursing school, do no harm. But safe within the context of, I think, the Healthcare Reform Act, as well as within this study, says that it goes way beyond just do no harm. It goes to the very essence of making sure that the way we plan and the way we deliver care every single day has a system that says you're safe here. The very healthcare system that you're trying to use to get better should not do harm. And there are many ways that we will look at that it will look at that. Number two, it says that healthcare, this new system, must be effective. We know that in America, we have the highest cost system in the world, but we do not have necessarily the best outcomes. And it says that this system must absolutely understand that it must be evidence-based. It should be about the research, and that we as professionals must make sure that we are implementing this in our particular facilities, that we don't underuse what we know can be do better care, and we don't continue to overuse protocols that are now outdated. Patient-centered. You know, we saw some excellent examples in the video just a few moments ago about true patient-centered. Patient-centered, again, what time I get up, what time I go to bed, all of that is extremely important. But to me, and I think what this study says, is for us to be successful, we have to understand in each and one, every one of our facilities, it is all about me if I am the patient or if I am the resident, and that I, in fact, have a very important voice in the decisions being made. Timely. It talks about, yes, long waits, not being able to get in to see a physician, not getting diagnostic tests, all of those types of things not being timely. But the most important thing, I think, for us is the fact that it talks about the fact that we must identify early and quickly interventions when we see patients or residents not doing as well as they should be. It talks about timely in a way that means that if you're admitted at 3 p.m. on Friday afternoon, you actually do need your medicines by 5 p.m., not on Saturday or, heaven help, on Monday. Timely care. Efficient. There will be an efficiency factor. And above and beyond everything else, we know that $550 billion is taken out of Medicare and health care reform. Efficiency is all about reducing waste. And that again, is going to speak very specifically to us. Equitable. Equitable talks about this universal access to health care, and it talks about it at the individual level, how I, the individual, receive my care, whether it's fair, whether it's right. It also talks about it from the population level. Minorities, the disparities that we know exist in health care for women from time to time. So these six aims guide and direct, and I will guarantee you that every single one of them are included in health care reform. So off of these six aims, within again the study, there are new rules. And I have studied these new rules, and I have looked at how do we implement healthcare reform, how do we be successful in this new era. And I think the new rules are extremely important. Number one, that care is based on continuous healing relationships. These continuous healing relationships means that care is given 24/7. That we use the internet for communication, that we use email for communications with families and interested individuals that want to be a part of the decision making and the understanding. It also says that continuous healing relationships are about the very relationships, again, that we saw demonstrated in the videos this morning. It is about interpersonal. It is about from resident to patient to staff. It is about including the community, the families, in building that continuous healing relationship. Care is customized according to the individual needs and values. Last year, in my presentation, I talked about an individual that I simply referred to as Hazel, who taught me so much about being a professional in long-term care. Because what I came to understand that Hazel actually was not just an 88-year-old individual. She was the person that was a young baby and a young woman. And until I knew all of her and understood her and her values and what she brought to this particular facility, I could not give her the customized care that she needs. It is about the person again, their needs, their values, everything that has built, and is so critical that we understand this in this new day of expectation. The patient and the resident is the source of control. If you take nothing else away today from what I talk about, this one has always had tremendous meaning for me. But I can tell you this year, it has taken on even greater meaning. My sister became ill last October. It was a very complicated situation. And actually, I've said that she and I went around the World Wide Web at least twice, trying to figure out what in the world, all of these things that are happening, but they don't seem to be linked. We went around the web until we pulled enough stuff together that, yes, we helped her physician staff diagnose her. And she has a very critical and a very serious disease that, in fact, is potentially fatal. It is rare. And we are very, very fortunate in that we were able to get a world-renowned physician from Johns Hopkins to take on her care. When we first approached Hopkins, we were, needless to say, very, very nervous and upset. And her, as he started to describe her care regime, the first thing he wanted to know after taking an excellent history were, what are your goals? What is it that you want to accomplish? Where do you want to be a year from now? She said, number one, alive. But where? What is it that you want to happen? So he really understood her. We started this complicated regime, and we go back about every month or so now. Last time we were there, he said again at the end, how are you doing? How are you doing? She said, well, I'm meeting my goals, but how are you doing really? And she said, well, good. I think I'm doing really good. And he said, why is that? And she said, I feel in control. I understand my disease. I understand what I need to do. I understand self-management. And I feel in control. And I think I'm going to be able to do this. He stepped forward. He's a phenomenal physician. And he said, you know, when I went to medical school, they kept telling us, give them hope. You have to give them hope. And I wondered what hope was. I just didn't know. And he said, then again, for me, a very personal thing. My father was diagnosed with MS. And in this very personal struggle with my father to understand the disease and for my father to understand what he needed to do to care and to do well, he said, I learned that control is hope. So if you take nothing else away, on our MDS 3.0 now, we have the question, do you have feelings of hopelessness? Because you have come into a nursing facility and you see this as the end of your life. We must do so much better in giving individuals what they need to have that control that they don't have feelings of hopelessness. The next bullet point, knowledge is shared and information flows freely, is all about that. It is their medical record, not our medical record. It is their access to everything, to their diagnostic. I hope if you're having lab work today, you're asking your physicians for a copy, that you're taking it home with you. It is theirs, and we need to stop being afraid of the potential lawsuit, and we need to move on and knowing that we share everything with the individuals. Decision-making is evidence-based. Evidence basis, it said in the AIMS, but that means that decision making is not illogical within an organization or across. If the hospitals are at this level in providing the expertise, we need to be there the same. It cannot be illogical. Safety is a system property. What this really means, and it works beautifully with QIS, it means that our care protocols and the way we run our facilities must be so systems driven that, in fact, it would, to the largest degree possible, prevent harm from occurring. It would be safe. But above and beyond that, the systems are such that when an error does occur, that we can quickly recognize it, correct it, and do better the next time. I don't know whether if any of you all had the opportunity to read the September Provider Magazine. And I think the title was something like Quality Takes to the Air. But it was about using the same protocols as we use in aviation to be able to do almost a checklist. I mean, you know, crossing the quality chasm was the next study following 98,000 deaths per year due to medical error. You know, if we had 98,000 deaths per year from airplane crashes, I don't think that would be a good thing. And I think we would be getting even a lot more attention. But the system's designed so we can learn it, we can recognize when it goes wrong, and we can mitigate any potential harm. Anticipate needs. Sometimes I think we are way too reactive in our care planning. When the problem occurs, we put it on the care plan. We know what the problems are usually. If I'm being admitted with cancer or end-stage renal disease, you know, we can anticipate what it is that we need to do. continuous decrease in waste, for us, this translates into very short, and I'm going to talk about it above and beyond everything else, elimination of unnecessary hospitalizations. I do believe that's where a whole bunch of that $550 billion is going to come from as we work on this. And then cooperation among clinicians. Again, joint decision making, but you know, it scares me to death when I walk into a nursing facility and I talk about report. And I hear from the clinicians, well, we don't really do shift-to-shift report anymore. We don't really give report to the nursing assistants. We really don't expect it back. So we have to have good cooperation within our facilities and within our organizations. But this goes one step further to say this is about transitions in care. And this is the information that we need to share with others where we, when a resident's going or a patient is going to the hospital, coming to the hospital from us. So in thinking about the six aims and the new rules, where do we go from here? I'm only going to highlight today 10 new areas. If these are the changing expectations, if you're like me and you have no life, you have read healthcare reform. All 2,000 plus pages of it. And there is a whole bunch of stuff in there for us, guys. Today, again, I'm not going to talk about each one of these, but these are the areas where I think that impact us immediately and that we have to use the new rules, the six aims, to make sure that we are going to be successful in the future. Value-based purchasing. Question came up about it this morning. That's all about being paid for the quality of what you provide. And Medicare is saying, we're not going to pay for poor care anymore. That's at least where we're going. Hospital readmission reduction program, elimination of the waste. The bundling, that's going to be a whole new financing program. And it's all about risk. It's all about risk. And who's going to hold the bundle of payment? And who's going to be willing to take the risk that says at every level that this individual is going to be a part of in every sector, whether it's home health, skilled, or hospital, if we don't all do it right, the bundle is not going to pay for the care. Whole new requirement around quality assurance. Again, something I think that QIS and Abacus is just center to. QAPI, I hate the acronym, but I think it's going to be a good thing. And mandatory compliance programs now. It's been voluntary for us since 1998. Now it will be mandatory. Patient-centeredness, we've talked about. Reduction in payment for acquired conditions, applying to hospitals now, but we'll be probably applying to everyone. Survey and cert, and then MDS 3.0. The last point is the enforcement provisions. I'm not going to talk about those. I'm simply going to say that the consequences for failure have gotten much greater past or post healthcare reform. In talking about all of these areas, I'm just going to focus on three. Because I think in the massive amount of to-dos in healthcare reform, unless we pull them together and make sense of them in a way that says we don't have 50 things to do, we need to do a few things very well, and the rest will take care. So the first, avoidable hospitalization. The second, designing, developing, implementing plans of care. And the third, quality assurance. Avoidable hospitalizations. I think this impacts those first three areas that I highlighted in healthcare reform. And the change for us, and if you've not read any of these studies, even if you have a life, you need to read some of these studies. What these studies show is that anywhere from 40 up to 60, and some are even greater than that, percent of individuals coming or being sent to the hospital, may have been avoidable. Up to 60% of patients going to the hospital from our facilities perhaps did not need to go. Now, that is waste that this country and we can no longer afford. Hospitalizations, what is the definition? Obviously, you can see this is condition-based diagnosis, those things that we all know well. UTIs, upper respiratory, all of those things that we know, electrolyte imbalance, dehydration that takes so many of our patients to the hospitals. But the last bullet point is what I really want to bring to your attention. These are conditions that stem from the hospitalizations that stem from these conditions that are thought to be largely avoidable or manageable if the conditions are treated in a timely manner. The word timely. Go back to the aims. This is exactly what healthcare reform is asking us to know and understand. And as you start to track and trend and look at these hospitalizations, I think you will see what this clearly means. How important is this? From my perspective, Andy was so nice to talk about some of the things and the policy things that I have done in my career. But I'm going to tell you, bullet point number one is where it all started and where it still starts. So avoidable hospitalization, quality of care, and quality of life. How many of us have looked in the face of a resident that says, I don't want to go to the hospital? And they're pretty cognitively okay, and they don't have a catheter, and they don't have a restraint, and they don't have a pressure ulcer. And they come back to us confused with a catheter, maybe with a pressure ulcer, and many times they never come back to us. They never come back the person. So it is about the quality of care and quality of life above and beyond everything else. We know more about providing geriatric care than the acute care, and we should. It's our specialty. The second bullet point here, it gets real serious about our survival and how well we're going to do. And that means reducing payments to hospitals for readmission within 30 days. Guys, this starts next week. This starts for these three conditions. This is real right now. This group will be expanded probably, I think, before 2015. But what I really want to say to you is the hospitals are taking this very seriously, and we need to take it very seriously. The American Hospital Association has put out a guide about what hospitals should be doing. And one of the questions on the guide, and it's big, there's a lot of things they should be doing, but one of those is do your referral sources, those individuals, those nursing facilities, skilled nursing facilities, do they have a formal program in place to reduce unnecessary hospitalizations? And if you don't, I'm thinking they may not be referring too many patients to you. So where do we start? I'm working, my largest client that I consult with is Sava Senior Care. So what I'll share with you over the next minute or two is some of the things that have been going on in Sava about what do we do about this. The first, I think, is what I call admission commitment. And that is to have an absolute profile of your facility on who you can admit, who you have the competencies to take care of. And if you don't know your profile, understand it. This is a joint effort with the entire interdisciplinary team. Understand it. And if your community has a need, a new orthopedic surgeon moves into the local hospital and you've not been doing that before, then develop that competency and then create that partnership. MDS 3.0 tells us that we must have a formal discharge program. For unnecessary hospitalizations as they come back against our particular claims, it will be if they go back to the hospital within 3 days post-discharge from us. So it's critical that you know that your residents are ready and your patients are ready to go home. And a formal program to eliminate. The first bullet point here on what do we do to eliminate. Consider every unplanned hospitalization in your facility avoidable. This is really hard to do. Because the first thing we want to do as clinicians is say, well, they sent them to us too sick. We want to defend the reason why we sent them back to the hospital. Just consider if it wasn't planned, Mrs. Smith was planned for surgery on Monday, that was planned. If Mrs. Smith went to the hospital on Monday, she wasn't scheduled for surgery, that was unplanned. Then track and trend. You must do this. You, as Andy said earlier, you must understand. If Mary Ousley is the charge nurse on 3 to 11, and every time Mary Ousley is the charge nurse on 3 to 11, five patients go out, there's a problem. If every time Dr. X is on call and all your patients go out, you've got a problem. If on weekends and safe care 24/7, no change in staffing. If on weekends and on Sundays everybody's going out, you've got a problem. But you've got to track it and trend it so you understand so you can solve it. Then it goes into QA and A. This is absolutely critical. The program that is out right now, it was developed by the Georgia Quality Foundation. It's free. It's in the public domain. It's being implemented. The quality improvement organizations are working with this, is Interact. If you don't have a program, again, at Sava Senior Care, this is the program that we are implementing. Where we are doing well, it has phenomenal results. It has phenomenal results in helping you understand. And the program, you can see all the words here, it's comprehensive, it's all of those things. But it's actually pretty simple. The first thing it says, we need a way to observe. Everyone needs to observe, whether it's a housekeeper, a CNA, everyone, and write it down and communicate what I saw. Mrs. Ousley didn't eat lunch today. You know, she usually gets up and wants to go somewhere, and today she doesn't want to go to activities. She doesn't want to do anything. First is observation, a structured way to communicate with each other. SBAR, situation, background, assessment, recommendation. How many times have you heard the nurse on the phone saying, well, I don't know, I've been off 2 days, but he doesn't look good. Now, is it any surprise that the doctor says, just send him out? Structured way to communicate with other healthcare professionals. Tools, clinical pathways to use, evidence-based, and a very good documentation and transfer system record. It is simple, guys, and I promise you it works. If you don't have a formal program, consider it. It's all about the plan of care. Second area. While actually the plan of care impacts all 10, I highlight three here. What I think for us is that MDS 3.0 gives us a chance to really rethink what we have been doing around assessment and care planning. Barb Bayless and I have talked about this several times. Where did it go? Where did we start to lose control of this critical core system in our facilities? Look at your process. Look at your systems. Look at them against evidence-based. This, I believe, is the essence. And you see Steve Levinson's name on the bottom of these slides. I kind of tinkered with the slides a little bit, but Steve did a presentation at MDS 3.0 training sponsored by CMS in Las Vegas that I thought was the very best presentation perhaps I have ever heard on care planning. And these are just a few of the gems that he talked about. Formulate the clear picture of the resident, the story. I don't think we do a very good job of that. I don't think we do a very good job of understanding always, what are all of the things inside of me? How did I get here? What is my history? What's my medical history? Did I have rheumatic fever at age 6? I did, by the way. Not that you really cared. But, and how did that impact my life? How did it impact the way I feel about medicine? Getting the story so that you understand. And again, I walk into nursing facilities and I pick up the care plan and it's this big and we have a falls care plan. And we have a wound care plan. And we have this care plan. But we've never really looked of, do we have multiple causes of a single problem? So we've got to deal with all of them. Or do we have one problem that are causing multiple issues to go on? We have to get more effective at this to meet the expectations. The resident and patient-centered preferences, personal goals, I talked about my sister within that context. The resident voice should be heard. I asked you earlier to note control. If you only take two things away from this presentation, take this. As I went through 5 days of very long MDS 3.0 training, and I listened to all the interviews and everything that we've got to learn and everything that we need to ask, and again, they are in concert with QIS, and that is really critical. But what I really was afraid of was that we will listen to the resident, we will write everything down, but then we won't plan around it. That it will get into the record, but we won't take that information and actually develop the care plan that fits me or Mrs. Smith or Hazel. And if we don't, in this new expectation of quality that talks about patient-centeredness, because that is the core of it, we will not be successful. We certainly will not be successful on QIS, or really the traditional survey. And again, interdisciplinary. When did developing care plans and doing assessments become an MDS coordinator sitting in the office, looking at records and filling in holes on the MDS? If we don't get back to the interdisciplinary process, and guys, it's evolved in all of our facilities, but interdisciplinary with everyone there, with the director of nursing, the medical director being the champion of this process and developing this system that communicates with the resident, with the family, with the patient, and with the staff, the communication is absolutely critical. Because if you develop this care plan and nobody, the direct caregivers, never know it. I went through 4 days, 5 days of training on QIS in a Colorado facility, a good facility. A facility that on average in Colorado is a very high deficiency state, 10 to 11 on average. And this facility usually got 4, 5, 6, very compassionate staff. And so we went through the interviews, and we looked at the records, and we looked at the care plans, and we went out on the floors then, and we started asking the nursing assistants, tell me about what you're doing for Mr. Smith or Ms. Smith today. Some of them knew, most didn't know what was on that care plan. And if they did know what was on the care plan, they didn't know why they were doing it. I've always said that most people will do almost anything if they know why they're doing it. So this communication, once this plan interdisciplinary is developed, is absolutely critical. The last area that I'll talk about, quality from the bedside to the boardroom. And that's exactly what QAPI is all about. The key change for us, and again, it impacts certainly the compliance program, our QANA, and it is critical for survey and certification. Again, in the traditional, but most assuredly in QIS. And I think Abacus can be a key part of this. Comprehensive matches the services provided by the organization, both clinical and non-clinical. Both clinical and non-clinical. For those of you that have heard me speak over the last 20 or 30 years, you've always heard me talk about the fact that our management must be driven by quality, should be a quality management system, and it must be a business model. It must look at the entire systems around the delivery of care, which include financial, it includes maintenance, it includes all of this. So QAPI says it must match the services actually provided by the institution or the organization. That is really critical. And that the governing body must be responsible. If you're independently owned, then it is the owner at the top of that pyramid. If you are a multi-facility organization, it is the board of directors. And they are not going to take this lightly. That it can't be just let the nurses go do it. As you all know, that's been kind of a pet peeve of mine. What is it about Quapi that may be just a little bit different? Myself and Steve and maybe several others in the room, I've been honored to be asked by CMS to be a part of the early development. We have now been appointed to the official TEP that is designing this, and this is on fast forward. Secretary must establish and implement this program by 2011. But the part that I want to bring to your attention is that in by December of 2012, skilled nursing facilities must submit a plan to the Secretary on how they will meet this standard and how they will implement best practices. QA&A flows right into it. And you know, we've had the requirement for QA&A legislatively since 1987, by regulation since 1990. This says not only do you do it, but you submit your plan to the Secretary and it will be validated. Exactly how? I assume through survey cert, I don't know yet, but it will be validated. Ownership and engagement of the leadership, absolutely critical, has to be there. But what I want to point out in this particular slide, sustained compliance. Dr. Kramer just showed some very powerful slides about those individuals that are using Abacus, some using it a little bit, those that are using it a whole lot. Mark did a phenomenal presentation this morning on survey and certification and what we have to do to be successful. And I agree with every word that he says. But above and beyond everything else, we have to be using systems within our QAPI programs that are going to tell us that we're in compliance every day and we're not worrying about survey window or doing a mock survey. This is critical. Your improvement activities, just make sure that they meet your facilities. And it's not just about problems. It is about implementing new programs, a system that whereby we can do the whole thing. The next area, and you may think this a little strange, that I come right off of quality, assessment, performance improvement, and go into compliance. Now, as I said, we have had the opportunity to have a voluntary program since 1998. It is no longer voluntary. Within 36 months of enactment of this bill, it is mandatory. Certainly there are some of us in the room that have worked with large multi-facility organizations that have had mandatory programs in the past. What I want to bring to your attention here is that, yes, in bullet point number 2, we talk about for a program to be effective, it must detect criminal, civil, and administrative violations. But above and beyond everything else, the underlying portion, it must be able to improve quality. Lots of words on this slide, but what you see here, the program, there's 8 components. Those 8 components have pretty much been the same since 1998, and probably the majority of us know them. Having good standards, knowing how we're going to be held accountable, what kind of audits are we going to do, what kind of disciplinary measures will we put in place if the standards aren't met, how will we improve? What I want to be able to say to you is that on both QAPI, quality assurance, performance improvement, and compliance, don't wait. Start now. Again, at Sava Senior Care, working with their excellent staff there and their CEO, we began the evaluation in June, shortly after the bill passed, of the entire program that's in place in the corporation, from the top to the facility level. We have redesigned that program now and actually took it to our quality council last month to be approved. We will now start to design the education and the programs around it, and we'll be doing full field education starting in January. I think this is really important. It takes us a little while. We have had 20 plus years now to have excellence in QA&A in place. Some of us do, many of us do not. So we have to really take it very seriously. I have tried my best, and I failed, to talk with CMS about the fact that I would like to see the quality assurance performance improvement program actually and the compliance be one and the same, that I would like for us to be able to do that. They disagree with me, and I can understand that. They feel that there has to be a separate program. But what I want to say is make sure that you implement the two programs in concert, that one supports the other, that you may have a QAPI, a Quality Assurance Performance Improvement Project, that you take to the level of what you think is best practice, then you pass it off to the compliance group that will maybe do routine audits. There may be things that the compliance program will be doing that they find such a significant issue that they believe that it should be moved over to quality assurance and performance improvement so that we can work out a project and then pass it back and forth. To me, that is absolutely critical for success here. Today, start looking at your basic program. How's it handled? Is it good enough? If it's a single facility, is it good enough? How do we improve it? You can find so much stuff on the internet about the quality assurance performance improvement program, so use it. Start your design now. So I end this program, actually on time, which is amazing, where we started, with the six aims. I hope that while I've talked, you've seen that these aims have been integrated into all of the portions of healthcare reform and how it impacts us. Just last week, I was in Denver, Colorado, speaking for my good friend Arlene Miles at the association. And at the beginning of her awards banquet, she does a slideshow, and it's a slideshow created from pictures that the members send all year long. As I sat there last week and watched this, while dabbing my eyes, of course, I thought about my career in long-term care. I thought about this presentation about quality. And I thought how incredibly proud I am of what we do and having been privileged to be a part of it. What I saw on those slides were not any of the ugly things that we sometimes see in the press and see in the news. And for those of us that have sat down before Congress to testify, that you've got the big picture of the pressure ulcer over there and something else equally ugly over here. What I saw were the hands reaching out, the smiles, the hugs, and faces again like those that we saw on the video. I close this with one last thought. I added a bullet on this slide, and it's about leadership. I don't think any of us would be in this room today if we were not interested leaders in long-term care. I like to say that I want to add to my resume or my introduction that I was a part, among several others, that was the research team that selected Mark Parkinson as the new CEO, president and CEO of AHCA. I think he gave us such inspirational leadership in his words this morning. But you know, it is easy to be a leader when everything's going really well. Healthcare reform gave us a lot of to-dos. Think about what we need to get done, and we need the strong, exceptional leaders in this room today to help us get it done. Thank you very much, and I look forward to your questions later.